Okay, take a marker out, please, and do me a favor. I've seen this tested before. This sentence, highlight, please. The images ask you this in true or false questions. It says a live entry is when the entry summary documentation is filed at the time of entry with estimated duties. Okay, highlight this, and when you review this, please pay attention to that because this implies that you should know what is not a live entry, because live entry you must have entry summary documentation, which is 7501 entry summary, and duties, right? We all know that sometimes you do not file entry summary, you file entry like form 3461 and then pay duties later. Wait 10 days and then file 7501. Okay, that's not live entry when you're at this step. At this step, it's live. Okay, so just highlight this. I've seen it tested, and make sure when you review this, because you will be. You know what I will do? I will ask you to review this on a regular basis. This is what you will need to do. Hopefully, it will catch your eye. Okay, next. Block three is covers the summary date. Okay, it covers the date on which entry summary is filed. One thing I must point out is that entry summary date is not necessarily the entry date, because we can have entry summary which is different from the entry date, or for that matter from the date of import. I don't have much to say about this one in within itself. I haven't seen many questions with respect to that. Just know that entry summary date is not necessarily the import date or the date of entry. Okay, next, surety number. Surety number is the topic which I will cover in more detail later. We came across this already. Surety number is that insurance company which approves your bond. Once your bond is approved, that means that you will have certain number. The company that is acting as a surety, it cannot just start its business. It must apply with the Treasury Department. And Treasury Department, once it approves, it gives a certain number. And once you make a contract and purchase a surety bond, then that is the number that you put in block four. That's all what it says. And when do you not need, when you can leave it blank? Anyone? When do you not need a surety? Informal entry. Yeah, so you can leave it blank if you're doing informal. And 7501 can be used for informal entries. Correct? Okay, however, if you are required to file a surety, you must differentiate between the bond. So entry types not requiring the bond, so this will be like informal. But there is also type 8 and type 9. We will be covering the difference, but for now note that continuous entry bond is when you import multiple transactions. Usually the threshold amount is $50,000. So if it's $50,000 or more, usually continuous bond is required to be filed. If it's a single transaction, $50,000 or less, then you can file a single transaction. Okay? There is a whole directive which we will cover. It's a piece of paper like that, except it's all about bonds. We'll go into detail. For now, just know that you would be dealing as a customs broker with two types of bonds. So when you have an importer, you will have to ask, okay, what kind of bond would you like, continuous or single? And when they ask, what's the difference? Well, for now, no, that the difference is in numbers, number 8 versus number 9. But you also know that continuous is for multiple transactions spanning over a period of time versus one short deal. And then there is this $50,000 threshold. Next. Single bond, I'm sorry, man. So, oh, you're talking about the minimum charge. The minimum charge usually refers to, so, I remember there was a minimum charge, but I'm not talking about the informal. Informal entry is the entry when you have a, $2,000 threshold. If you have informal, you do not need to be bonded unless it's a special type of merchandise. I believe if it's an anti-dumping bond is required, and I believe it's textiles bond is required. We're not talking about exceptions. $100 charge, I believe, refers to the payment for the bond, right? That, I believe, is in the outline. Unfortunately, I do not remember if it's required or not at this time. Sorry. I will make a note and I will get back to you though. $100 charge. Okay. Let's move on. Port code. Does everyone know where to find the port code? Annex C of the Harmonized Tariff Schedule, it's in the back. It's usually 4-digit port code. What's the port code for New York?
1001.
Okay, and you needed to know that, right? What about New Jersey? 4601.
Right?
Don't worry about the writing. You will have to look it up anyway. So, the point of the port code is you have to know where to find them, that's all. Next, entry date. Okay, entry date is not necessarily the summary date, okay? It's the date on which the goods are released. And then there is exception, of course. There is a immediate delivery, IT. There is a quota. And the filer requests another date of release, which is a possibility. But general rule, when the goods are released, this is a date of entry. This is a default rule.
So when you do the immediate delivery, what's the entry
date? Immediate delivery is a, it comes in Miami for Minneapolis. The entry date is when it enters Minneapolis. The import date is in Winters, Miami. Okay? So that is the difference. Because when it's under the immediate delivery, the goods are not released. You cannot take them out. You can transport them, but you cannot take them and sell them on the side.
Take it to the destination? That's the entry date?
Yes. It goes in, but then you have to make you file documents too in Minneapolis. For example, until you file the documents, the goods are not entered.
Do you mean this release is withdrawal from the warehouse? Or?
If you make a withdrawal from warehouse, the entry date is the day you make an entry for the withdrawal, you file 7501. Mm-hmm. Once customs approves it, mm-hmm. usually they give you notice. If you do it electronically, they send you the message back saying released. That's your entry date when you got that message.
Is this the sending of the withdrawal from the
warehouse? Same thing, yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes. The problem with immediate delivery is when you bring things in, many people may be thrown off because it's inside the country, it's moving from Florida, let's say, from Miami to Minneapolis on the rail. It is very easy to get into the mindset that, yes, since they are moving inside the country, they're kind of released, right, from Port of Miami to the Port of Minneapolis. But at the same time, no, they're released only to get from point A to point B so they can get cleared in Minneapolis. So this is important to you. They've been approved for transportation, and that's in. Okay, I think I just said something wrong. Immediate delivery is not necessarily IT. I'm confusing with IT. Immediate delivery is when you have perishables, like strawberries, okay, which cannot wait in the heat of the Mexican border and must go directly to the warehouse for to be cooled, okay? And once they're in the warehouse, you have to wait for customs to release them. This is a concept which we'll talk about later. The general rule is when they're released. Immediate delivery is not when they're released. I have strawberries, I have blueberries. I cannot wait for them to rot in the sun. I have to bring them into the warehouse in a cool place. And once they're in the warehouse in a cool place, I have time to fill out the paperwork. I have time to maybe sort out bad strawberries from the good strawberries. And I have time to have inspector come in and make the approval, if they want to examine. That's immediate delivery. I immediately deliver them to the warehouse. It's possible to do for the special types of merchandise. Okay? And again, we shall talk, this is introduction to the entry, so we shall talk about this in more detail later. But this is a general rule. Entry date is when it's released. And why is it important? Because entry date usually drives the duty rate. The duty rate is determined on the date of entry. Of course, there are exceptions, but that's a general rule. Okay, importing carrier is next. What should we know about importing carrier? Here is a question that has been asked before. Get a highlighter and underline this. The reporting of vessel flag is not required. This was asked a number of years ago. Again, it's in statistical note one, but who remembers that? We have so much information to remember. It's just an extra piece. And I think it's one of those true or false questions, which one is false? Is reporting of the vessel flag required? No, it is not. However, IATA alpha code corresponding to the name of airline is required. Each airline has its own identification code. I believe IATA stands for International Air Traffic something. I'm not sure, but it pertains to airplanes. So I guess what customs examiners are testing you on is that they're testing your knowledge land versus sea. If it's a sea, then the vessel flag is not required. But if it's air, you have to disclose more information such as IATA code. Okay?
So do we have the IATA code in the HTS? No, right?
The IATA code in HTS? No, you will have it in Bill of Lading. So you will get airway bill, I'm sorry.
They will not test us.
They did test before on whether reporting vessel flag is required or not. But conversely, they can test you on IATA. On this one, I think if they test on this, this is ripe for questioning. So know that vessel, if it's a sea vessel, ocean carrier, the flag is not required. The IATA code for if it's air vessel, airplane, it is required. That's the way I would just make a mental note in my head. And so yeah, this is all I wanted to say about the block 8 of 7501. There's other information, but haven't seen it tested much. Now, Next one is a mode of transport. So each mode of transport has a code. Remember we discussed in block 2 the entry type code. So if it's warehouse entry, it's type 2. If it's consumption, it's type 1. If it's anti-dumping, it's type 3. Well, if it comes in by certain type of mode of transportation, you also must assign a code. And the way that you may be tested on is just like you can be tested on entry type. You'll be given an invoice, and you'll be given some kind of vessel, blah blah blah, and then you'll be asked to pick the answer, and one of the answers will have type 11, and they will say something, which one is false or which one is true. Okay, this is typical exam approach. So know that the block nine contains your answers, and most heavily tested are type 11. So what I would do is I would make myself a note. Just review, type 11 is vessel container, international shipping container. Those things that we see on the road all the time, which look perforated. Next one is rail container. Then there is truck, usually for NAFTA or Canadian shipments, non-container and container. And then highlight also 40, air non-container and air container. Okay, those are, if they're gonna test you, more likely those are the ones that you'll be tested on. What is 11? What is 40? You have containerized cargo. Anyone know the difference between the air container and the vessel container? So air container looks something like this. So it can fit the fuselage of or the salon of the airplane surrounded. Okay, any questions on this? This is just stuff you need to look over frequently and memorize. Those are the easy stuff. Country of origin is more tricky. Look at what it says. It says, well, first of all, you must use international standard organization country code, which is Annex B. Okay. Annex B, if this is where you find out that MX stands for Mexico, RU stands for Russia, United States for United States, US for United States, and so on and so forth. This is where you will find out whether stuff that comes from the England should be declared as stuff that come out from Great Britain, from United Kingdom, from England, or from some other name which I cannot think of. Wales. Or this is when you know whether to declare Heineken beer as country of origin being Holland or Netherlands. Okay, you, this is your chart. Where is Annex B of the HTS? Everyone knows? HTS US Annex B. Here. It's way in the back here. Statistical annexes. So you have custom core codes, which is C. Right before it, you have international standard country codes. If anyone curious, so how would you label England? Anyone? UK? UK or England or what?
I'm looking. It is called. How do you label England?
So it's GB? GB. Yeah. So you're not using EG or you're not using UK, right? All right. There was a question on Great Britain. I think which repeated several times in the last 5 years. So this is where you go to look for your country code. Right? So Ireland, for example, is IE. And IR is Iran. One would think that IR is would be for Ireland. No. So, very important part. Know where to find it. I don't think it will be very fruitful for you to memorize all this stuff, but just know that this is a part where you go for your reference. Okay. So we're still in country of origin. We know that we need to go to the Annex B to look for the countries. We know that UK is England. And we also know that not everything sometimes is always made in one country. You can have some pieces coming from various countries and being assembled in one, and then being transformed in another, being packaged in another, being labeled in yet another country, and being, stored in another country. All right? So what is the rule of thumb that tells you this is a country of origin? So let's say the tomato was grown in Ireland. Then it was dried in Wales. And then England. Then it went to in England it was dried. In Denmark it was packaged and put flavoring upon. In Amsterdam, which is Netherlands, it was packaged and labeled. And then it came to Canada where it was mixed up and then imported into United States. What's the country of origin? Okay, see a bunch of steps that it took? So what's your rule of thumb? By the way, I do not know the answer to that. I just made it up. But you will have questions, although less involving less steps. So the rule of thumb is highlight this, this whole thing, but underline this especially. The rule of thumb is substantial transformation. The country of origin is the country of manufacture, production, or growth of any article. Of course, by word country as singular, it presumes that one article is made in one country. If the article consists of material produced, derived, or processed in more than one foreign territory or country, foreign meaning outside of the United States, or insular possession of the United States. So if you have insular possession, which includes Marshall Islands, which includes Guam, which includes US Virgin Islands, which includes Saipan, what else is insular possession? I haven't seen Guantanamo. I think Guantanamo has a special status. But if insular possession, okay, is also considered to be the product of that country or possession, the product of Guam, where it last underwent substantial transformation. And that's the best they can do. Customs to this day has not promulgated any regulation that says this is the meaning of substantial transformation. So it's an eye of the beholder. To make it easier, they did make some rules on case-by-case basis if this article is subject to the free trade agreement. So if you have NAFTA, you have objective criteria, you have tariff shift. If the tomatoes were changed from original fresh tomatoes to the dry tomatoes, and then went from, let's say, chapter 16 to chapter 20, they say, look, if they made the change from one chapter to another, they jumped, that's substantial transformation, that problem is met. But if it's not a textile, for textiles they also have chapter shift. If you jump from one chapter to another, or from one subheading to another subheading, this is how you determine, okay, in this country it was changed from this HTS to this HTS. In that country it was made to change to this, HTS to this. That means it qualifies for origin. If it's a textile, you can do that. If it's a free trade agreement, NAFTA or Morocco, you can do that. But if it is, for example, European Union, which has no free trade agreements as such, it has general MFN, most favored nation type under WTO, but that's it. No bilaterals. So if you have something like Switzerland, which is, by the way, not part of the EU, or if you have something like UK, and you need to determine whether the product underwent substantial transformation from in UK from Switzerland, so it can, you should declare it is UK, not Switzerland, then and this is not a textile, then you have this ambiguous substantial transformation, kind of like, yeah, it probably underwent substantial transformation. So, objective for textiles and bilateral free trade agreement. Subjective all others. Subjective mean you just have to look at it and kind of like essential character, right? You have to try to figure it out. Customs examiners usually will give you a big clue if there was a substantial transformation by saying you started with metal and you ended up with a bicycle made out of metal, let's say. That type of stuff. So because if they're gonna stick at the subjective where it was marginally transformed, right? This is very easily appealed. Okay. So next. Don't hide your highlighters. Please make sure to I felt like I was substantially transformed. Alright. So to the country of origin. So if this is 9802, which is a special category, the country of origin should be shown as the country in which the repair alteration of assembly was performed. So you have a special category for chapter 98. If stuff were done, so my watch broke, okay, it is under warranty and it is being fixed in Canada. What I do is I ship it to Canada and then back after they fixed it, okay. It undergone repair. So when it comes back from Canada, I declare Canada. I do not, even though just a repair was done, it's the same watch, they just fixed the one screw that didn't work, for example. Okay, next. Just to drive things home, highlight this portion. The actual country of origin shall be specified rather than the country of invoice or exportation. Yeah, a lot of things happen in this world which lead many exporters and importers into a world of trouble. They transship stuff through Honduras from China and they say nothing happened in Honduras, it was just loaded from one ship to another. It didn't even leave the container. So country, maybe it even left the container, but nothing was done to the article. Sometimes you see people saying, well, it came from Honduras, so the country of origin is Honduras. No, it's not Honduras, it's China. You have to have substantial transformation before anything else to qualify it. And substantial transformation is not mere taking things out and putting things in. There is an exception to that. I know of only one, and that's a Singapore free trade agreement. I do not know how they've done it, but they went to United States Trade Representative, the government body which is responsible for free trade agreements, and they say if it's stored, if it comes to Singapore and just stored, and then leaves the Singapore to United States, then you can use Singapore free trade agreement. So you, I think you still label it as, for example, country of origin of China, but you apply Singapore free trade agreement to the article. I do not know of any other. So very unlikely that they will ask you about it, but just keep in mind, Singapore has a special rule. I think Singapore Integrated Initiative, something like that, it is called. If you'd like, I have an article, I can send it to you, but you probably have so much information to deal with, you may not want to read it. Now, let's see. If more than one country of origin, market is multi, many. And then at the each level, so you will so this is your 7501. So let's say you have country of origin, let's see. So you have country of origin here. Oops, again, I did it again. I don't want to do that. Okay, country of origin. So if I have more than one country, that's country of origin, I put multi here. And over here, at the line item, I say Singapore, I say UK, or I say CN for China. This is how I identify. So that would be my hint, look here. Next. So this is a typical question, right? Customs examiners, they give you this type of invoice and they say, okay, look at the invoice. And answer the following question. The question is this. The international standard ISO country code identified at block 10 of CBP form 751 is which one? And they give you this information. And by the way, this is a snippet of the country. Which one? How do you know which country it is? This is all you have. Usually you remember, you put the country, they're not giving you the country of origin. You may put the country of origin here, right? You know, AGOA. AGOA stands for African Growth Opportunity Act. So it must be Africa, right? We have Libya. LY stands for Libya. We have Ethiopia. Then this is Germany, United States. Well, it's possible United States, but not likely. I don't know what EG stands for. What is EG?
EG is Egypt.
Oh, so those are possibilities, right? We have Libya, Ethiopia, Egypt, right? That's a question. What's the country of origin? Okay. Go to page 19 of your CBP 7501. We'll go back to we're gonna fast forward a little bit. Okay. And take a look. Highlight, take a highlighter and saying this, the second and third positions. Represent the ISO country of origin code. The second and third provisions, this is a visa. Remember we talked about visas? You get a visa, so with visa, like just like if you get a visa in your passport, there comes a visa number, right? This visa number must be reported to customs. But that visa itself is not an arbitrary number. So what customs is expecting you to do when you show up at the exam is you must know what this number represents. And one of the things they test you on it is they give you the visa number and ask you what's the country of origin. So let's go back. This is a visa number right here. I don't know if I can make it bigger and less fuzzier, but that's it. That's the visa number. Second and third position here, it's not second and third, here it's rather. Oh, second and third, yes, because V stands for visa, so it doesn't count. This is second, this is third. So it's ET. This is the answer they're looking for. This is how you know from the invoice what the country of origin is. See, they're being tricky with you, right?
Where could you see the ET? I mean, I still don't.
Okay, let me make it a little bit bigger if I can.
Oh, see, I got it.
V3ET022805. ET stands for Ethiopia. If it was Libya, it would be V3LY. Okay? So, indirectly, you think that they are testing you on country of origin, ISO. In fact, they are testing your knowledge on your ability to decipher visa enumeration process. See? Okay, any questions at this point? It's one of the things you just have to know. And there is no logic, but if they decided it should be last four digits, I would have no way for you to reason that they decided to do that. They just did. So this is the way they do it. Just keep that in mind. Okay, next. Next. So, I fasted forward to page 19, which deals with visa number. But we're still on block. Okay, we're still on block 10, country of origin. This is the relationship between block 10 and block... What is it? The block 32. Block 32. Okay, so that's all what I wanted to say about the country of origin. Any questions before we move on to the other blocks? So a substantial transformation. No, that it can be objective if it pertains to textiles or FTAs, but subjective case by case inquiry if it is other. Okay, Canada. Keep in mind, when you declare Canada as your country of origin, you do not say CA. You use the province. And province codes I used to have a location for the See, they have a link for the Canadian. I think they are in the same schedule. See, let me click on it. No, they didn't tell you. Okay, the Canadian province code are listed. I believe in. Let me see. Okay, so they right there. Okay, guys, I'll send you the separate email for Canadian province codes. Just a moment. What I wanted to for you to get out is country of origin. You declare Alberta or BC, British Columbia, right? But if you're talking about not the block, let me see, CBP 7501. If you're not talking about the block country of origin, here you declare the province. But if you're talking about the HTS free trade agreement, such as NAFTA, like CA or MX, right? You still use CA here at this level. Because this level, this it's called SPI, Special Product Indicator, will allow you to claim the preferential duty. So here, you say BC, British Columbia. Here, you say CA, and you use the HTS US number, okay? That's the point of filling this one out. Or same thing goes to Mexico, Jalisco, right? What is it? Jalisco, HL. Here is MX. Guadalajara. No, it's a city. My favorite is Yucatan. Okay, any questions? May, have a question? What page are you on? Page 6? Okay, just a moment. Let's get it together. So, ISO country code CA for Canadian goods of Canadian origin no longer will be reported as a country of origin. The top box. Okay? Since 1997, the Canadian province codes replace CA. However, it's a general rule, right? And we all know that where there is a general rule, there is also exceptions. And the exceptions are the following. You have five of them. Six exceptions. If you withdraw it from the warehouse to consumption, you use CA. But why am I not making big deal out of it? Acceptable means not required. So you will not get rejection. You may have an angry customs official who's calling you saying that you're not complying with the local port practice. if you're a soft person, you may be upset about it, but hey, it's acceptable. So if it's not required, then I'm not making it a hard point drive that saying that you must. But C is acceptable if it's warehouse, FTZ, informal, imports of Canadian origin arriving from countries other than Canada. That is possible, right? With a substantial transformation. Canadian stuff came to Mexico. Nothing happened in Mexico. They were just labeled. So suits were labeled in Mexico. Came to United States. Country of origin, Canada. Label doesn't transform the suit, right? And we have other stuff which I don't want to pollute our brain with, but yeah, we have FDA, DOT, EPA, and cargo selectivity. You guys wanna talk about it? Okay. Import date. So remember I mentioned that stuff comes into the Miami, gets on the intermodal, IT immediate transportation, and then goes to Minneapolis. Well, the import date, you put the date of Miami, of arrival to Miami, not date of arrival to Minneapolis. That's pretty much what it says. Also, what has been tested on? So grab a highlighter and highlight this. Arrived within the limits of the US port with intent to unload. Import date, so mere arrival. So you have a ship which is at the port, container is still on the ship. It didn't hit the land yet, it didn't hit the port, still in the waters, can still be considered the import date. That's the key for you to think about. And this is a type of flexibility that is allowed within the US customs practice, because import date, remember when we're talking about import date, unless otherwise requested, I think the date of entry, okay? So that flexibility, you have a variation. Usually when you submit the entry summary, and the port must be within the shipment must be within the US port limits for you to submit the documentation. You get a notice of release before even the merchandise hit the land. Okay, that would be the import date, and that would be the release date, even the merchandise didn't come on.